Back in the 80s, with just a few lines of code, you could program a game of tic-tac-toe. Back in the 90s, with just a few lines of code, you could program a website that allows you to play tic-tac-toe with your friends on the other side of the planet. Back in the 2000s, you could, with just a few lines of code, program a game of tic-tac-toe that you can play on your phone. And these days, with just a few lines of code, you could program a neural network that learns by itself how to play and win at tic-tac-toe. Wait, what? So let's take a step back. Hi, I'm Dalya Gartzman, and this is me. I have a master's degree in pure math. I did my thesis in computational biology. For the past couple of years, I've been an algorithm developer in the smart mobility domain, and next month, I'm starting a new job in the construction tech. And above all, I learn a lot from the internet. And actually, everything that I'm going to talk about today, I learned by myself from the internet. And if there's one takeaway that I want you to take away from this talk, is that whoever you are, whatever pile of Lego blocks you are, you have what it takes to make a cool data science project. Okay, so let's start. And before we start the intro to data science talk, I want to make like an intro to the intro. So we're going to take three very big questions and we're going to answer them very shortly. First, what is data science? So here's a diagram I copied from the internet. It says that data science is the intersection between programming, mathematics, and domain knowledge. Domain knowledge means that if you want to start a startup that involves tourism in Malmo, then maybe you should know Malmo and know what it means to be a tourist. But the thing is that this looks like a pretty heavy backpack. So I want to change the question for a moment and ask, what do I need in my backpack to make a cool data science project? And I'm going to take inspiration from, what? GeForce is ready? Whatever. Okay. I'm going to take inspiration from Dora the Explorer. She explores the entire world with just a tiny backpack. So let's think of what's the tiniest backpack that we need to make a cool data science project. So I think what you need is some basic programming skills. I'm going to assume you all have them since you are here today at Øredev. You need some basic data science concepts, which I'm going to talk about today. And you need a cool idea. And I'm going to provide some ideas that I think are cool, but the thing is that once you get the basics, you're going to have plenty of ideas on your own. So, next question. What is machine learning in a nutshell? This is not a crash course in machine learning. I just want to establish some common language so we have some basic concepts that we can use during the talk. So before we talk about machine learning, what is human learning? So in classic programming, I have a task that I want to perform. For example, I want to know which shape am I seeing. So as the designer of the program, I need, as a human, to learn how to perform this task and then communicate to the machine how the machine now needs to perform this task. So for example, maybe I understood that you need to count corners. I need to understand how to count corners, to teach the machine how to count corners. And then if you see zero corners, it's a circle. If you see four corners, it's a square. And machine learning, again, in a nutshell, is learning by examples, which means that I, as the designer of the program, I need to design a learning scheme that allows for me to introduce examples for the machine to learn by itself. So maybe I show the machine a bunch of circles and I say, these are all circles, a bunch of squares, these are all squares. And then when the program sees a new shape that is never seen before, maybe they can, it can understand if it's a square or a circle, if I designed my learning scheme correctly. Third question, what is a neural network? Tip of the iceberg, really. Again, not a crash course, just establishing some common language. So what is a neuron? I'm going to tell you a little secret. a neuron is just a fancy name that condescending people use to tell, to call a function. Now, we all know what a function is, right? We have an input x and an output y. And remember, we're in the world of machine learning, learning by examples. So maybe you have some input and output of examples from the world. And then I, as the designer of the function, the neuron, what I do is I tell the neuron, listen, I think there's a function here of some shape. For example, maybe I say to the neuron, listen, there's a linear correlation here between the input and the output. And the thing is that now the neuron, the function, I can also call it a one learning unit, I show the neuron many examples of input and output, and the neuron can figure out which exact straight line best describes the relationship between X and Y. And then the next time I introduce an example of something that the neuron has never seen before, then I get the input X, and then I look in the line, in the orange line, what is the output Y. Okay, so a neuron is a function, so a neural network is a function, is a network of functions. That's it. You have lots of functions, lots of neurons that feed each other, like some function's input output is another function's input. And we are in the world of machine learning, so we have inputs X and outputs Y. And we build a neural network that we show it many examples of input and output. And then the next time that we have a new input that the machine has never seen before, that the neural network has never seen before, then it's going to give us an output that we hope it will be kind of true. So I, as the designer of the neural network, I need to think about the architecture, meaning which functions which feed which other functions. I need to think of what are the functions. So we said each neuron is a function, and I, as the designer of the system, I need to tell the neuron, like, kind of guide it in the right direction of which kind of shape the function should have. And some more stuff that if you dive deeper in the iceberg, you can discover. So part one recap. We have, like Dora the Explorer, a very small backpack where we have the nutshell of machine learning and the tip of the iceberg of neural network. And I think that's enough in our backpack to explore some data science ideas. Okay, so what can we do? What can I do? What can you do? So in this second part of my talk, I'm going to explore three major subdomains of data science: natural language processing, computer vision, and predictive analytics. For each one of them, I am going to give you a link to an online free learning course or any learning resource that I personally recommend. I'm going to give you some tools that you should that you can use in this context, and I'm going to give an idea for a project. And I'm going to also already give a little spoiler. In the third part of my talk, I'm going to talk about something that involves music. And the reason I put this in my talk is that first, I'm going to talk about a project I did in a hackathon with a group of friends. And it's super cool, and I'm really proud of it. And the second reason is that I think it illustrates how far-reaching these skills are. So I'm going to give you like three very specific subdomains. But the thing is that once you get the concept, then everything that you can imagine that you can enhance using code, you can probably also enhance using data science concepts. Okay, so first, natural language processing. And I'm going to start with a personal story. So when I finished my master's, I left the academy, and I was like, I didn't even know that there's a thing as the industry, and what does one with a master's in math can do in the world? And I sat with two coffee cups with people, and like, hey, I met you in school, or I know you from back then, and maybe you can help me in understanding the world, and what can I do with my knowledge? And I met this friend, and he told me, oh, you should do CS224N. And I was like, what? What does it mean? And then I went home, and I wrote on Google CS224N, and I found this amazing new world of free online courses from Stanford, the university in the US. So they have really high quality free online courses. So these are actual courses that are being taught in the university, but they're free online for everyone. And I mean the talks, the videos, the slides, the background, some tutorials, the homework assignment, the solution to the homework assignment, like everything you can think of. It's a really, really good resource to learn. So rather randomly, I stumbled upon natural language processing because this is the theme of this course, and I took some classes, and I never finish mostly anything that I start. So about like a third way into the class, I was like, wow, this is amazing. Like, I have to explore some by myself. And I, one of the things that I learned during this course is a thing called word embedding. And so the idea is that we have a language, like you can take the dictionary and read words in alphabetic order or whatever, but these words are correlated to each other in some meaningful way. And the word embedding, the idea of word embedding, is to take an entire corpus of knowledge. For example, in this paper, they used a dump of Wikipedia from 2015. So they took the entire Wikipedia, put it in this algorithm that they called word2vec. And what does it mean, word2vec? So we take the words in the dictionary in Wikipedia, and we embed them in a high-dimensional vector space. What does it mean? So imagine we are in 3D now. So imagine there are like dots in the room that represent words. And the idea of how this algorithm works is that it kind of magically preserves semantic and syntactic relationships between words. So for example, if I take the dot that represents man and then the dot that represents woman, and I draw a line, and then I look for the word king, and then I take the exact line and put it here, then I'm gonna reach the word representation of queen, which is kind of mind-blowing. Like, you take Wikipedia and then you get some sort of what does it mean to have some relationships. Like, you just kind of teach the machine to understand language. I say kind of, and there are some implications, again, if you go down the iceberg. Okay, so I saw this and I thought, oh, this is really cool. And I started looking up some stuff on the internet, and I stumbled upon this extremely cool YouTube channel of this guy called Siraj Reval. I've watched so many of his videos. And in one of his videos, he does this live coding where, so remember we said word2vec, what they did in the paper, they took Wikipedia and then put it into the dictionary to get an embedding in vector space for the words and get kind of like human, or what is represented in Wikipedia of the language and the relationship between the words. So he took all of the books of Game of Thrones and put them in the same algorithm to get an embedding of the books. So you get kind of like, what does it mean to speak the language of the books and to get some relationships. And the thing about what I mentioned before about the vectors, so what you can play is a kind of association game. So I'm gonna play a very short association game with you. England, UK is to London the same as Sweden is to Stockholm? Okay, I learned something new today. And I learned it using humans who understand knowledge and language. But the thing is that you can play this association game with a machine. So for example, in the previous example, you could say man is to woman as king is to, and the machine would answer queen. So what Siraj did is he played the association game with the embedding of the Game of Thrones books. And I highlighted the wrong, anyway. So he's like querying the embedding, and he asks, Jaime is related to sword as Tyrion is related to wine. And I saw that and I was like, oh, this is so cool. I want to do that too. So obviously I stopped the video in the middle and then I sat down to do the same thing by myself. So my favorite book series when I was growing up was Ender's Game. So I downloaded illegally, don't tell anyone, the entire corpus of the Ender universe, and I put it inside the this algorithm, and I produced an Ender to Vec. And no spoilers, but in the first book, there are these brother and sister, and they're called Peter and Valentine, and they write in this online forum, and their pseudonyms are Demosthenes and Locke, maybe the other way around, anyway. And so I played this association game with my word embedding, and I was like, I was doing like a... I was really excited, and I was like, oh, please, I wish it works. And then I queried my my word embedding, and I asked it, Peter is related to Valentine as Demosthenes is related to Locke. And I was like, oh my God, I'm really, really geeking out right now. You can do it with your favorite book series, and I promise you, you're gonna geek out as well. So what I wanted to illustrate in this part was that I learned something new from an online course. I discovered something new that I wanted to explore a bit further. I found a really good YouTube channel that gave me an idea for a project that I can do by myself. And this took me maybe a weekend. It was the first thing I did on Python, so really basic programming skills. And the weekend included installing all the Python packages, which is not that easy, and reformatting my computer because I installed them in the wrong order. Never mind. So this is like something that was super fun for me, that I felt like, yeah, I did something. It's not like I learned something theoretical. I just really made something that made me happy, and I'm still talking about it. And back in the day, back in those times, I was looking for a job, so it was something cool that I could talk about in job interviews. And now I'm gonna give some links. You don't have to take a picture. There are gonna be so many links in this talk. In the last slide, you're gonna have a link to the slides. It's already available online. So let's continue to our next subdomain. Computer vision. So again, Stanford to the rescue. They have a course called CS231N. And as you can imagine, it's about neural networks for computer vision. And the cool thing, like you go to the website and their landing page is they have this network is running live in your browser. Let's decompose it for a moment to understand what it means. So remember, we have a neural network, a network of functions. We show it many examples of input and output, and then we expect the neural network to learn how to perform a task. So here, what they did is they chose the architecture, they chose the functions, they chose other stuff, and then they had a neural network, and they showed it many, many examples of a picture and the thing that is in the picture. For example, here it's a bird. So they showed it many, many, many examples, and then the neural network knows how to classify objects in images. And now this neural network is sitting in the back end or the front end, I don't know, somewhere in this website. And when you go to the website, there is a generator that shows the network a picture that it's never seen before and asks it to classify it live right now. I think it's pretty cool. And it's already an idea for something that you can do as a cool data science project. Okay, so I took this class, didn't finish it. I took a few classes, it was really interesting. And also, I forgot, I really want to mention here another really, really good YouTube channel. It's called Three Blue, One Brown. And this guy, he has very visual videos involving math and physics concepts. I think it's really good if you want to get some basic math concepts, then he explains them really, really well, and some stuff that are just interesting and fun to watch. But in this context, so he has he has an entire series about neural networks. So if you go into this course of CS231N and it's a bit too hardcore and it involves so much math and so much like deep knowledge, then go to 3Blue1Brown. He has really good explanations on what is a neural network, how does it learn, and what does it mean to do stuff with neural networks. Okay, so some tools that you should be aware of when you're doing something with neural networks, especially in the also in the context of computer vision, but in general. So there's a Python package called TensorFlow. And remember we said that a neural network is like many functions feeding each other. So TensorFlow allows you to build this neural network in a very, like, I'm going to use the Lego blocks analogy again. So it resembles more to building something with a Lego blocks. And there's another package called Keras. And the analogy that I want to make here is that if we want to build a neural network in like Lego blocks chunks, not like program every function and the learning process, which is super complicated to program. So no, TensorFlow is like the tiny round stuff on the top of the Lego block, and then Keras would be like an entire Lego block. So you just chuk, 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 poof, neural network. And what I really like about Keras is that it has excellent documentation, and it's just, I feel cozy when I go on the Keras website. It's like the landing page is like, you have just found Keras. And I was like, yeah, I did just find Keras. And there's really good tutorials, and it's super fun to learn from there. And another tool that you should be aware of is PyTorch. I haven't used it myself, but all of my friends are like, oh, you're using Keras? PyTorch is the whatever. So I want to say in this context that this world is changing so fast. So, like, don't even bother to try to keep up. It's just do whatever you feel is cool and easy for you. And no one knows, like, we had the tip of the iceberg. No one really knows the tip of the iceberg. Like, the iceberg is so big. There is not one person who even knows just the tip of the iceberg. So just feel comfortable where you are. And if you found a tool that you like and it's easy for you to use, just use this one. And don't let other people make noise and, like, use PyTorch. No. Okay. Anyway. And so we said you have the red, the round dots of the Lego, which is TensorFlow, and then you have the Lego blocks, which is Keras. So you can also download from Keras the entire Lego house. Like, you can do from Keras import ResNet 50. So you can look it up, what it says ResNet 50. So it's a neural network that already has the architecture, already have the functions, already. It's already been taught to perform a certain task. And you can just, you don't have to do any of this. You just download the Lego house. So what can you do with this Lego house? So preparing for this talk, I thought of ideas of what can you do with it. So I came up with the following idea. So I have some friends who have a WhatsApp group with a kindergarten teacher. And the kindergarten teacher every day sends them pictures of their kids, of all the kids in the kindergarten. And no one cares about other people's kids. You only care to see your kids. So an idea that I have is to program a bot that looks at the picture that are sent in the group and only notifies you when there's a picture of your kid, which is the only thing that you actually care about. Now, how would you go about doing something like this? So remember, Keras lets you download an entire house of Lego. So you can download an entire house of Lego that knows how to classify images or even images of people. And you can just add a couple of Lego blocks. It's not like super 5 minutes. It takes some understanding, but it's pretty much like this. You just add a couple of Lego blocks and you say, okay, you already know how to identify people and animals and whatever. Now also learn how to identify my kids. You all have dozens of, those of you who have kids or pets or whatever, or yourself. You can teach the neural network to perform another task on top of the task that it already knows to perform. So that's an idea of something that once you have some basic concepts and you know some basic tools, then I think this is something that you can do over a weekend or a hackathon or a couple of days. And I don't know how to program a bot and how long does it take, but I'm guessing it's doable. Again, lots of links. You're going to have links to the slides. Okay, last in this section, predictive analytics. So in predictive analytics, remember, in a nutshell, we're in the world of machine learning, learning by examples. So in predictive analytics, in general, the idea is that I want to learn the future by, I want to predict the future by something that I learned from the past. And a really great online resource for understanding the concepts of predictive analytics and actually machine learning in general is Stanford to the Rescue, a Stanford course taught by Andrew Ng. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. It's spelled N-G. He's one of the founders of Coursera, which is an amazing online resource for so many classes in so many domains. And he has a course in like basic machine learning. It's like just a few days to do. And he goes through many basic concepts of machine learning. It's like the hello world of machine learning. Like if you understand, if you want to understand some basic concepts and to understand the jargon and some buzzwords, then I highly recommend. It's really just a few days to complete. Okay, so once you did the basic machine learning class, or maybe just a couple of, it's very divided by subjects, so it's really easy to just pick and choose. So once you did a couple of those, some useful tools that you should know. So in predictive analytics, again, in general, you have tabular data, meaning you have rows for examples, for samples from your data set, and you have columns for features of each example. So Pandas is a Python package that allows you to manipulate this tabular data very easily. So think SQL, but in Python and fun and like fun, which is not SQL. And then once you manipulated this data set and did some stuff, then you have a mind-blowing Python package called scikit-learn. And the thing about scikit-learn is that you don't, like, everything is already prepared for you. Like, basically, every machine learning algorithm that you can think of is already implemented in this package. So normally, in a, like if you just want to do something cool for yourself as a starter, you take a tabular data, you do some manipulations during using pandas, and then you do like from scikit-learn import whatever algorithm dot fit, and that's it. Like you don't need to understand how the algorithm works or how to implement it. It's really easy to do cool stuff. So challenge yourself. What can you do in this domain of predictive analytics? So there's a really cool website called Kaggle, your home for data science and machine learning. And what this website has is like literally infinite amount of data sets that you can play around with. And for some of these data sets, they come with a question. Like it's called a competition, and the idea is that you have a data set and you have a question involving this data set. So for example, a couple of years ago, there was a competition by Quora. They released a data set of like many, many dozens, hundreds of thousands, I don't remember how much, pairs of questions for Quora that some of the pairs were marked duplicate and some were not. And then the challenge was to learn how to say if two questions are duplicate, or like the same question. And how it works is that you get, like, maybe you can register to the competition, or if it's a past competition, you can still register and get the data set. And you do the learning phase, and then you submit your code. And then there's a hidden data set that no one has ever seen that your code is tested upon it to see how well did you do this task of marking pairs of questions as duplicates. So how nice of the Kaggle people to add a tab for getting started, because this world of Kaggle is literally infinite, not literally, but you know, literally. And so the getting started tab is super useful. It has three basic competitions. And for some reason, I don't know, for some reason, the data set of the Titanic became like the hello world of predictive analytics. I know there's a major shipping construction past here in Malmo, so I hope I'm not offending anyone's ancestors. But so it sounds a bit morbid. It is morbid. The data set is the list of passengers on the Titanic and whether they survived the crash. And the idea is that you're supposed to predict who is going to survive the crash. The fun thing about it is that in Kaggle, you can see other people's code and other people's submissions. So what I did when I looked it up is that I went to the submissions tab and I took the highest ranking team on the scoreboard and I looked at their submission. And they were pretty cool, and their submission is super organized, lots of explanations, the code is super clear. And I learned, like, I thought I knew a little bit about this before I went into this page, and then I found out so many ideas on how to manipulate the data and how to extract information from it. So I highly recommend, if you want to learn some like implementable skills, go to a Kaggle competition in a domain that you find interesting and look at other people's submissions. So an idea for a cool project that you can do in that regard. So I was looking up data sets in Kaggle and I found out this really cool data set of beer recipes and how people ranked them. So I have some friends who make beer at home. I'm super lazy, so I don't. But I have this dream of one day, if I'm ever gonna make beer at home, that I'm gonna use this data set to learn like the best recipe that would make me that would be the most tasteful for me, and I would like the make the best beer first time I try. I'm too lazy, but maybe one day it'll happen. Okay, links. So the recap of the second part of my talk, I hope I convinced you that this world of data science, machine learning, AI, neural networks, whatever, it's a super exciting time to be living in and to be exploring this as increasingly complex tools are becoming increasingly accessible. And all you have to do is understand what tools are out there, how they can be used, and like mix and match for whatever, wherever your imagination takes you. And now, for the last part of my talk, music. And again, I want to start with a little personal story. So a couple of months ago, I was interviewing for this company, and the job involved signal processing and music information, stuff that I didn't even know existed. And I got this home assignment, and my mind was blown, and I had a really good time, and I didn't get the job because my home assignment wasn't good enough. And a part of me was like, I was so sad, like I really wanted this job. And then this other part was like, hey girl, chill. 2 weeks ago, you didn't even know music information existed. So, but then this other part was like, hey, but I learned so many cool new things and I want to do something about it. So I wrote a blog post where I put up some stuff that I learned during the interview process. And so first I turned a bad experience, not a bad, but like a sad, half sad experience into a happy one. And the second thing that happened as a result of this blog post was that a couple of months later was the yearly data science hackathon in Israel. It's like a really big event and it's super fun. And I gathered some friends and we formed a group and I sent them the link to this blog post and said, maybe we can do something with this. And they all said like, yeah, cool, let's do something that involves music. Okay, so we gathered in the hackathon and all we decided was that we're going to do something about music. And what I'm going to talk about now, I'm going to present quickly this project. So it's 40 hours from brainstorming to presenting to the judges. So this is like very contained. So without further ado, I'm just going to start. And I'm going to give you the pitch. Okay, so imagine that you in the second row looking surprised, you wrote a song. You wrote a song. You rhymed all the rhymes. You have all the chords. You even recorded an audio of your song. But now you want to make a video. But who has energy to make a video? Video that to the rescue. We are going to automatically generate a music video for your input audio. And how are we going to do that? So the premise is that if you have matching audios, you're gonna have matching videos. What does it mean? So what we did is we took, many videos of Taylor Swift, music videos of Taylor Swift, and we took an Arctic Monkeys song. So now that we take an audio snippet of Arctic Monkeys, and we take an audio snippet from a video of Taylor Swift, then if these audios correlate, then if we take the video from Taylor Swift and put it together with the Arctic Monkeys audio, it's gonna look quite all right. That was the premise. This is what we hoped for. Okay, so how did we go about performing this task? So our data set, as we said, we used the top 30 videos of Taylor Swift on YouTube, and we used a tool called YouTube DL to extract all these videos and manipulate it and stuff. Then once we have the videos, so the first step was to deconstruct each video into the scenes. So we take like complete scenes. We used a Python package called PyScenDetect that just automatically separates the video into the scenes. Then we used another Python package called Libroza, which takes the fingerprint of the audio of each snippet. And what does it mean to get a fingerprint of the audio? So a fingerprint of the audio could mean so many things, but remember, it's a 40 hours hackathon. We don't have a lot of time. So we implemented the first thing that we could think of, which was onset pattern. So onset is every time a sound starts. So when I speak, it would be like every syllable or every word. But in modern music, that could happen many times a second. So if we take this pattern of how many onsets were in each time window, then we can get a sort of a sense of like the flow of the audio. Okay, so what do? We have the audio of the Arctic Monkeys song, and we have tons of scenes of Taylor Swift videos. For each one of them, so now we start the song, and then we take, for each one of the Taylor Swift videos, we take the audio, say what is the correlation to the next audio snippet in Arctic Monkeys, we take the best one that fits, and like that, we greedily compose a Taylor Swift video for an Arctic Monkeys song. I'm gonna show you that. It's just 30 seconds.
Away.
Okay. That won us second place in the hackathon. Okay, so it's the final slide of my talk, and I want to go back to my first take-home message, which is that whoever you are, whatever pile of Lego blocks you are, you have what it takes to make a cool data science project. And I want to please try and remember the first time you ever wrote a piece of code that does something. Like, the first reaction is like, whoa, this is magical. And then it just becomes doable. It's like one of the skills that you can use to make cool stuff. So these days, it's the same way for data science. First time you do something, it's like, oh, it's magical. It continues to be magical. But it also becomes doable. And then anything that you can imagine doing something with code, then you can also imagine of doing something cool with data science. So I hope I filled your tiny backpack with enough Lego blocks to continue your journey. And whenever you find a Lego block missing, look up any of the many links in my talk. And just have a happy exploration. And thank you so much for listening.